So we've built most of the computer, and in the last video, we programmed the control logic with enough microcode to be able to execute a simple program here that loads a value from memory, adds a value from a different location in memory, outputs the result, and then halts. And that's programmed into the computer now, so if I start the clock, you'll see it loads and adds and then outputs the result here. Now the question is, what happens if I want to run this program again? So to run the program again, we've got to reset the computer, which right now is kind of cumbersome. So the way that we do that now is we have to stop the clock and then reset each module individually. And each module has a reset signal hooked up to it. So for example, the program counter, the reset signal is here and is currently high. If I take it low, then that resets the program counter to zero. With the A register, it's currently low. And if we take it high, that will reset the A register. Same with the B register. If we take that high, it'll reset that. The output register, if we take it low, it'll reset that to zero. The instruction register, if we take that high, that'll reset that. And then the memory address register, same thing. If we go high, that'll reset that. So now all of these modules are reset, except for the micro instruction counter here, which is still on T2. And that has a reset as well. But remember, that reset is already hooked up to T5, because when it counts up to T5, then it resets back to zero. And we don't really have an easy way right now to get this to T5, because normally you'd increment the, advance the clock, and it would count through. But because the halt, we have a halt condition here, the clock's not going to do anything. So what we need to do is connect this to ground, this reset signal to ground. So what I'll do is disconnect this existing connection here to T5, and then briefly connect that to ground to reset that. And then once that's reset, now all of the different modules in the computer are reset, and if we start the clock again, the program runs again, and there's our output. That was pretty cumbersome. So what I want to do in this video is build a circuit that gives us a simple push button that we can push that resets everything all at once. So the circuit to do this is actually pretty simple. So there's basically just a push button switch that when we push it, connects 5 volts, but then normally the output here is tied low through, this could be like a 10K resistor or something. And then that voltage we just are gonna buffer so that we can drive the reset signal, which goes out to various different modules in the computer. Of course, some of the modules have an inverted reset signal, so we have an inverter here that will give us that as well. So some modules have a reset, some modules have an inverted reset, so we just need to make sure that we have both of those signals available when we push the button. The other thing is this step reset, which currently is connected to the T5, the time step 5. So currently this wire here is connected from T5, so when this ring counter gets to time T5, then that is connected around to the reset here for the 74LS161 reset. So then that resets. Yeah, so in other words, currently this T5 is just directly connected to this step reset signal. So what we want to do is we want to put an AND gate in here so that normally this is going to be high and this is going to be high, because these are active low signals. So if both of those are high, then the output here is going to be high as well. So we're not going to be resetting, because this is also an active low. But if either of these goes low, either because we push the reset button and we want to reset it, or we get to time T5 and we want that to reset it, then this step reset will go low and that will actually reset our microinstruction counter. So this is fairly straightforward. We need a buffer, an inverter, and an AND gate. But to make this a little bit simpler to build, we can actually just do this with a single type of gate. So we only need a single chip that has that type of gate on it. And so here I've redrawn the same thing using only NAND gates, and that'll allow us to use a 7400 chip that has 4 NAND gates on it, and conveniently this circuit uses 4 NAND gates. And so one thing you'll notice is a little bit backwards here is if you connect both inputs of the NAND gate together and then you look at the output, then the NAND gate is going to act as an inverter. So this first gate here is actually inverting, and so the first thing we get out is our inverted reset signal. But then if we invert it again using another NAND gate, then we get our reset signal. And so then both of these signals will be buffered and we'll have our inverted reset and our normal reset. And then of course our AND gate, we can use a NAND gate, which is an AND gate with an inverted output, and then we can just invert that output again. And that gives us our step reset, same functionality here. So we have our inverted reset coming in here, our time step T5 coming in here, and then these two gates together act as an AND gate in the same way that this one did. So we can use the 74LS00, which has 4 NAND gates on it, to build all of this. So it doesn't really matter where I put this reset button on the breadboard, because it's going to have to connect off to everything. But since we are going to be messing around here with this, T5 and the reset for this, it might make sense just to put the reset circuit right around here, where it's nice and close. So I'm going to put our reset button right there, and then just hook up one side of it to 5 volts, and then the other side through a resistor to ground. And then we've got our 74LS00, which has our 4 NAND gates on it. And I'll connect up power and ground for that as well. And so then the switch is going to connect into 2 inputs of the first NAND gate. So I'll go ahead and connect that to one of the inputs, and then just use a jumper to connect those 2 inputs together. And so then the output of this NAND gate is right here, and this will be our inverted reset coming off of here. That's also going to go into 2 inputs of the next NAND gate. So I'm going to use another jumper to connect to the next NAND gate over. And then the 2 inputs of that NAND gate are also tied together, so I'm going to use another of these little jumpers to connect those 2 inputs together. And so then the output over here from that second NAND gate is right here, and that's our non-inverted, oh, you can't see that. That's our non-inverted reset signal right here. Now for the second part here, for the the time T5, we're anding that with our inverted reset. We want to connect our inverted reset, which is right here, right? Because this is input 1, input 2, and then output of that first NAND gate. So this here is our inverted reset. We want to connect that around to one of the inputs of another NAND gate. So I'll just connect that around to one of the inputs here of a NAND gate down here on the bottom. And then the second input here for that NAND gate, I want to connect to T5. So let me disconnect power for now, and then pull this connection out, because we're going to replace this connection with this AND gate circuit, right? Get rid of that. And then that T5 connection is actually going to come up and go into the second input of this first NAND gate on the left here. So that's T5 coming up there. And then the output of this NAND gate here is going to go to the 2 inputs of the next NAND gate. So we'll connect the output to the next NAND gate there, and then we'll connect the 2 inputs of that next NAND gate together. So this is where we're NANDing those 2 different signals, and then the output of that is going into the 2 inputs of the next NAND gate. And then this pin here is going to be the output that goes to our step reset. And so we can just connect that output down to our step reset down here. And so that hooks up everything for this circuit here. And we have our inverted reset, let's see, here on this pin. And then we have our non-inverted reset over here on this pin. And so now we just need to connect those 2 signals up to various parts of the computer. For example, if we look at the instruction register right here, the reset signal there is connected to ground. So that's normally connected to ground, and then when we connect it to 5 volts, that resets it. So that's the regular non-inverted reset, which is this pin here. So we can connect that, get rid of this, and connect that directly to the instruction register like that. And so now when we push that button, it'll reset the instruction register. So another part of the computer that uses the non-inverted reset is going to be the memory address register up here. So we can connect those together as well. So I can just connect from the memory address register here down to our instruction register down here. And so now get rid of this. Now our button over here will reset both the instruction register and the memory address register. And so we'll just connect the rest of the things in the same way. So from the memory address register, we can come over to the A register, is the same way. That goes into the reset here on this chip, which then is connected over to this other chip here as well. And then the B register, which is down here, we can connect that up to the A register. So these are all connected together now. Now we still have a couple other things. For example, the program counter up here, you can see that's tied high because we have to take it low to reset that. And then same thing down here for our output register, that's high, and then we have to take that low to reset that. So for those, we'll connect the inverted reset signal, which is right over here on this pin. No, this pin here is our inverted reset. And so we'll bring that up and connect to our program counter. So there's the program counter, and then finally we can connect that down to the output register, which is down here. And I can kind of tie some of these in place here with this little jumper there, hold things together. And so that's all of the reset signals for all of the different parts of the computer. Now we can reset by pushing this button. So let's give it a try. So I'll connect power, and I'll start by stopping the clock, going into program mode, and actually I'll try to reset, and we can see a couple things did look like they reset, but we'll see here in a minute. So let me just quickly program that same program into the computer. So we'll go to memory address 0, and we'll put in a load A 14, and then we'll go to address 1 and put in an add 15, and then address 2 we'll do an output, and then address 3 we'll do a halt, and then address 14 we'll put in the number 28, and address 15 we'll put in the number 14. So those will be the numbers we add. Go back into run mode, and if we start the clock, this should run and we should see our output. And there we go, there's our output, and we've halted. Now if we press the reset button, it should reset and run the program again. And there it goes, it runs the program again. And so we can just keep hitting this reset and it'll keep running the program each time. So that's certainly a lot easier. And we can also now go in and change, you know, our data. So instead of adding 14, let's say we want to add some other number. So I'll just flip some random switches here, set that number in there. And if we go back into run mode and just reset, now we get a different answer because we changed our inputs. We can go back, go to the other operand here and maybe set some other things, put in some other number, and rerun the program. And we got 12 that time. So that certainly makes it a lot easier to try out different things and reprogram it and everything without having to fuss around with resetting each module individually. So another thing I want to talk about, because this is a question that's come up from a number of folks, is power for the computer. And I'm currently using this 5-volt, 1-amp USB charger from an iPhone. And I've just, you know, have a normal USB cable connected to it that I've cut open, and I'm just pulling out the 5 volts and ground and powering the computer. And this is working reasonably well for me. However, this particular charger, and I think because it's rated at 1 amp, it does actually shut down. And that's because if I hook the computer up to a bench power supply and I look at the current that it's drawing, it draws, you know, somewhere between 1.1, 1.2 amps currently for me, which is more than what this is rated for. And so, you know, there's a polyfuse or something in here that'll trip and shut this down so that it's not, so it doesn't overheat or whatever. So that is definitely an issue. And so what I've found is I've found much better luck with this charger, which is a 2-amp charger. And if I connect this, then it'll also power the computer just like this is, but I won't have any problems with it shutting down. I can leave it on for, you know, several days and the computer works just fine. Whereas this will shut down after, I'm actually not sure how long it takes, maybe an hour or two, it'll shut down. And then it just turns off, and which is fine. It's just a polyfuse that's tripping in here to prevent it from operating outside of its spec. But this works just fine. Now, another series of problems is just getting power distributed to everything and getting enough power to everything on the breadboards. And I think I've got a couple things going for me. One is I'm using very high quality breadboards. In fact, the specific breadboard I'm using is this. It's the BB830 from, what is it? Busboard Prototype Systems, and I've, you know, maybe there's other high quality ones, but these are the ones I found that seem the highest quality to me. However, they can be a little bit challenging to find because sometimes you'll see things that claim to be this brand and this model and everything else, and when you order it, you get something different. So it can be a little bit tricky. But these I found tend to have very good connections, and so I think that's helping me run into fewer problems than other folks who are running into problems getting power distributed. Now, the other kind of breadboard that is very common is this MB102, and this is quite a bit cheaper, I found, than the BB830, at least the name brand one. Sometimes you'll order a BB830 and get one of these, so that's something to be aware of. These are much more common, I think, because they're much less expensive. This is, you know, $7 or $8, and these are, you know, sometimes less than $2. So, you know, it'll definitely work. A couple things I've noticed in terms of quality, aside from, you know, perhaps the connection quality when you connect to it, you know, how sturdy those connections are, is just a few other things, you know, just quality-wise. If you look at it like this, you know, this is the BB830, and you can see it's got these, you know, numbered holes from 1 over here all the way up to, you know, this is 60, so 63, so there's 63 rows there. Whereas if you look at the MB102, the numbers don't really line up with the holes exactly. So it's a little bit unclear, you know, is this zero somewhere? Or yeah, it's not clear what's going on there. And also the numbers on this side go backwards. So that's a little bit strange. The other thing is these power rails on the BB830 connect all the way across, and on the MB102, as the printing on here would indicate, they break here, so you need a little jumper to connect across there. You know, and just other things like the A, this is a row A, until you get to the other side where it's row upside down J. So just some kind of weird quality issues. You know, other things I've noticed is just when you're inserting, sometimes with the less expensive boards, you know, it can feel a little stiff. It can feel like you're not getting as good a connection, whereas the higher quality boards, it always feels like you're making a good connection every time. But of course, you want to weigh all of that against cost, because the lower quality boards certainly are much less expensive. And, you know, it may actually be better value to you to get the lower cost ones, depending on, you know, how much you're planning to use them. So another thing to be aware of that I've noticed is, just as I wiggle this connection here, the power connection, you can see, or at least I can see here, these LEDs are flickering a bit. Hopefully you can see that on the camera. And, you know, that certainly suggests that the connection, you know, just any of these connections on these breadboards are not going to be perfect. And that's the problem that we're sort of battling with this power issue that I think a lot of people are seeing. And one trick that I saw, I think this was Julian Eilert that did this on his channel, which I definitely recommend checking out his channel. He's working on a breadboard computer of his own that is a bit different from this, so I think it's a good complement to this, but I definitely recommend checking that out. I'll link it down below, but I think, you know, he used one of these sort of standard header things and just connected three of them together like this for the positive and negative. So connecting that to your USB power connector is going to give you a much more solid connection into the breadboard. And so I've actually found this to be a really great setup here with this three wide connection, because it's really solid. I can, you know, wiggle that and I'm not seeing any of that flickering. Everything even also just seems to be a little bit brighter with this. So that's definitely helping a lot. And then I'm just using the 2-amp USB supply. The 1-amp works, but it does cut out, and it's probably not terribly good for it to keep doing that. So anyway, those are just a few tips that I've got that I've kind of found with as far as power for the computer. But yeah, this is working just great.